Okay, this is lecture 12 on design of singly reinforced rectangular beams. That's what we are going to discuss today. So, as we mentioned in the last class, there are various steps involved in this design of singly reinforced beam. First, you should write all the given data, then determine the factored loads and the factored bending moment using effective span. So this factored bending moment should be calculated using the factored loads and the effective span, right? Factored loads involves both the live load and the dead load. Dead load means self weight of the particular element that you are designing. Suppose if you are designing beam, you should take the self weight of the beam also. If you are designing slab, you should take the self weight of slab, and so on and so forth. Next, you will determine the effective depth required by considering the balance section for a given grade of concrete and steel, and then you will provide effective depth more than that is required in this section to make a beam as an under reinforced. That we will discuss now. Now then, as I told you, design means you have to design the cross-sectional dimension as far as beam is concerned, and then you have to also design the tension and reinforcement, right? So next is the find the area of steel that is AST mean area of tensile steel required from the equation given, and it should satisfy the condition given IS code, AST minimum and AST maximum, right? Then you will appropriately provide number of rods, right? And then you have to check the spacing of the reinforcement. The reinforcement should not be placed too closely or too far. And finally, you will have a check for control of deflection as per IS code. And then detailing of the reinforcements. These are the various steps involved. Before going further, I want to make one important point. Now, when you design a beam as when do you design a beam as a doubly reinforced beam, right? Suppose if the factored moment calculated, if it is less than the MU limit at the limiting moment of the system, MU limit, then you will always design the beam as a singly reinforced beam. Remember, if your factored moment due to external load and self weight is less than limiting moment of resistance of the particular beam, limiting moment of resistance only depends upon the cross-sectional dimension, that is width and the effective depth and grade of concrete and grade of steel. Okay, so if MU is less than MU limit, you will design as a singly reinforced beam. If MU is greater than MU limit, you will design the beam as a doubly reinforced beam. Okay, so these are the things we have discussed up to step 7 in the last class. This I have included now. Now we will see an actual design of beam. So this is the first design that we are going to see. A simply supported beam of effective span 8 meters. The beam carries an UDL of 10.666 kN per meter, including the self weight of the beam. Okay. Design the beam for flexure. If the grade of concrete and steel respectively are M20 and Fe415. Okay. So here, please make a note of this one. You have to design a simply supported beam, and the span given is the effective span is given. And the cross-sectional width is given 250 mm. Now, here is the most important point to be noted. It carries an UDL of 10.66 kN per meter, including the self-weight of the beam. Means self-weight of the beam, it is already included in the UDL given. We don't have to separately calculate it. It is included in this UDL itself. Any member you design, it should withstand its own weight, and also it should be able to take some external load. For example, you have a electric wire in the pole, in the electric pole, the wires are the electric wire. it doesn't have any external force, it is only self weight. Because the span is very high and the section of the wire is very small, you will always find a sagging of this wire, right? Something like this, between one pole to another pole, the wire will be sagging because the span is very high and the section is very thin. So obviously, under self weight itself, it will start deflecting. Okay, that is why you should always check for. You should always design the element for including the self weight so that does not deflect. Okay. And design the beam for flexure. This is another one. Flexure means bending. You are supposed to design only for bending. Shear is not there right now because this will come in next unit. So we are going to design only for flexure, that is bending. If the grade of concrete is given as M20 and Fe415. So this is the problem statement. Now we will see one by one how to go about it. I would ask all the students to take a notebook because most likely you may not get this PDF because the design is long. Unless you write it yourself, it is going to be a problem. But I will provide, eventually I will provide the PDF, but I want you to pay careful attention and calculations and all, you try to do it. Okay. So as usual, what are the given data? Now given data is, first of all, it is a simply supported beam of span 8 meters. Which is subjected to a UDL of 10.66 kN per meter throughout the length of the beam. And if you take a cross section, width of the beam is 250 mm. Depth you are supposed to design, okay? Depth of the beam you are supposed to design, as well as the reinforcement you are supposed to design, okay? When you say design the beam for flexure, here width is not given, depth is not given, so you are supposed to find out the depth, that is overall depth of the beam you should find out. Okay, well, we will go ahead. So writing about given data, first one is, it is a simply supported beam, because you could be asked to design a simply supported beam or you can be asked to design a cantilever beam. So accordingly, your bending moment values and all vary. So first write down what type of beam that you are going to design. Simply supported beam. Now here, effective span itself is given. So I am writing L effective is equal to 8 meter. Sometimes they may say a simply supported beam of span 8 meter, then I will write only L, not L effective. Here it is mentioned the effective span, so L effective is equal to 8 meters. And the width of the beam, small b, is 250 mm. And the beam carries a UDL of 10.6 kN per meter, including the self weight. Okay, so here, this is UDL intensity is small w is equal to 10.66 kN per meter. Remember, this is not a factored UDL or ultimate UDL or a design UDL. It is simply given UDL. That is why this belongs to service load, small w, right? Most of the time, students make mistake here. They take this as a factored load. There is no such word like factored or design or ultimate load or limiting load is appearing in this sentence. So, you know, FCK, characteristic strength of concrete is 20 MPa and the steel is of 415 MPa. These are all the given. So, next. First, we have to find out, because you are designing the beam for a flexure. Flexure means you are designing the beam for a bending moment. So, first step after the given data is to find out the factored bending moment, right? Now it is a simply supported beam subjected to UDL throughout its span. What is the maximum bending moment in the beam? Narayan Raju, are you there? 44.
Yes, sir.
What is the maximum bending moment in a simply supported beam with a UDL? Please revise your strength of material. So given UDL is a service load, that is W is equal to 10.6 kN per meter. Now you have to find out the factored UDL. Factored UDL is W suffix U. Please pay attention here. Please mute yourself. This is small W suffix U. That is a factored UDL is equal to UDL due to service load multiplied by 1.5. So it is coming out to be 16 kN per meter. 10.6 is 1.5, 16 kN per meter. This is your factored UDL, okay, or design UDL or limit UDL. Now, factored maximum bending moment M is equal to WU L effective square by 8. Okay, actually W L square by 8. But here in a limit shape method, we are always using limit load and effective span. So WU L effective square by 8. WU is 16 kN per meter and L effective span is given as 8 meters. So W L square by 8. So bending moment is 128 kN meter. Remember, be careful with the units because your UDL is in kN per meter and span is in meter. So your MU is equal to 128 kN meters or 128 into 10 power 6 Newton millimeters. Okay. So if there is any doubt, please interrupt me. I am going to go ahead continuously. That is the first second step to find out the factored bending moment. Okay. In some problem, they may give you this factored bending moment directly. Then you can easily do it. But in some problem, they may not give you this bending moment directly. They may give you in terms of span and load and so on and so forth. So you have to calculate bending moment. For that, you should know what is the maximum bending moment in the beam. Okay. Now, next step is to find out the depth of the beam. I am written capital D. Capital D means meant for overall depth of the beam. Now, how to find out? So, in order to find out the depth of the beam, right, you know for Fe415 steel, the limiting moment of resistance, Mu limit, is equal to 0.138 FCK BD square. Remember, you have only three values. You can easily remember for Fe415. MU limit is 0.138 FCK BD square. For Fe250, it is 0.148 FCK BD square. For Fe500, it is 0.133 FCK BD square. Only three values to be remembered. So please do remember, otherwise you have to derive this. It will take a lot of time. Okay. So MU limit is 0.138 FCK BD square. What I will do is, I already know MU value from the previous slide. MU is 128 into 10 power 6 Newton millimeter. I know MU is this much. Now from this one, 8 FCK BD square. I know all the values except for D. I am going to equate MU and MU limit, and whatever D I will get, that is for the balance section, because this is for a this is the balance section moment, limiting moment. So you can derive this equation using this XU limit by D and 1.1C, that MU limit equation. Okay, if you use this one, you can derive this one. I have given a reference here. Now, 0.138 FCK BD square equate to MU, that is a factored bending moment. The only unknown is D, so find out this D. So D is required is equal to MU divided by 0.138 FCK under root. Okay, this is the D required. Now this D required is for the balance section, this balance section. Okay. Now here, 10 power 6. Divided by 0.138 FCK B, that is coming out to 430.71 millimeter. Now, all of you listen carefully. D requires 430.71. If you put here, this and this will be same. Both value will be same. Suppose, if I increase the value of D, This D required is for a balance section. To make the beam under reinforced, provide D greater than D required. Now, if I increase this value of D, instead of 430.71, if I put 440 here, obviously my limiting moment is going to increase to higher values. Because my D is more than this, my mu limit is going to be higher, mu will be less, so mu is less than mu limit, I am getting an under reinforced section. Is that clear? As I told, if your mu is less than mu limit, you will design it as a singly reinforced section. Is that clear? So, and also this, when you provide D more than what is required for balanced section, you are making it the beam as an under reinforced section, because you know xu is equal to xu by D is equal to 0.87 fy ast divided by 0.36 fck bd, like that, right? Now if you increase the D, right, this factor is going to reduce. Obviously you can say that this and this can cancel, but because if you see as a whole, if you see this xu limit by d is equal to 0.48, because if you increase the value of D more, obviously your xu limit, so it will become an under reinforced section. Okay, so here we are providing D more than D required. Okay, so now I have taken 460 millimeter. You can ask, that is why, as I told you, design problem, there is no unique answer. You can design in 100 different way also. Same beam, you can design in 100 different ways. Somebody may take 440 mm, somebody may take 450 mm, somebody may take 455 mm. That is up to you, but the value should be more than this 430. So I have provided the effective depth of 460 millimeters. Okay, right. Necessarily have to be this one. You can choose any value more than 430.71. So I have chosen 460 mm. This is only effective depth, but I have to find out the overall depth D. So before that, you have to check this one. Okay, whether this is sufficient or not, this D provided is sufficient or not, you have to check. The check is given, check for L effective by effective depth ratio. Now L effective is 8 meters given, so 8 meter means 8000 divided by D provided is 460. Whenever you are checking this, D is always D provided, so 8000 divided by, and this is less than 20, because remember, for a simply supported beam from 23.2, I don't know whether I have it here or not. I need to open it. So you see here, for a simply supported beam, span to effective depth ratio for up to span 10 meters is 20 mm. This is the maximum value. Okay, so that you have to check. If it is not satisfied, then you have to change the value of depth. Okay, so it is given in the code 23.2 for a simply supported beam, maximum value is 20. So you are getting 17.39. That is perfect. This value should always, L by D, L effective by D provided should always be less than 20. maximum it can be 20, but it should be less than, so 17.39. Suppose in case if it is not coming out to be less than this value, then you increase this denominator, that that it is less than 20. So okay, now I am going to assume an effective cover as 40 mm. Now how did I get this 40 mm? You can assume 30 mm. Like for example, in table 16, as I told you, nominal cover is given in table 16 of your code, in page 42 or something like that. 42 or 40. This is table 26. Here. See, nominal cover, actually your exposure condition is not given. So you can, minimum you should have 20 mm as a clear cover, nominal cover. Effective cover means you have to add the half the value of the main diameter. So I have assumed 40 mm. Okay, you can assume 30 mm, you can assume 35 mm, but I have assumed 40 mm because my D is 460 mm. When I add 40 mm, the depth will become 500 mm. Okay, so overall depth of the beam is equal to effective depth provided plus effective cover assumed. So 460 plus 40, 500 mm. Why I made 500 mm is, for example, let us say 460 mm is the effective depth, and I add effective cover as 25 mm, it will be 485 mm. Work in the site, actual site, laborer is going to provide. If he cannot measure 462.5, 463.5 and all, he cannot measure. He can measure only the whole number. That is why overall depth of the beam I made to 500 mm. It will be very easy for the laborers to provide this much depth. Okay, an engineer is not going to do all this job, but he laborer is going to work. That is why I provided a whole number of 500 mm. For that matter, I assumed a cover of 40 mm. Okay, now so my depth is 500 mm. So one part of the design is over. Okay, I have calculated overall depth of the beam to be 500 mm, and this is satisfying this relationship, L effective by D, it is satisfying. And this will be under reinforced section. So if you want, you can check whether it is under reinforced or over reinforced using this one. See, what is the value of if you, okay, later on I will come back to that later on, little while. Okay, next one. Next one is, we have designed the cross-sectional size is designed. Next, we have to design the area of tension reinforcement. Now, because we are providing D, this D provided is more than that is required for balance section, it is an under-reinforced section. In under-reinforced section, your steel will always yield first. Okay. Now, to find the area of tension reinforcement from your code, right? It is there in the annexure G 1.1b. If you have code, you please refer to that. You can easily find out where it is. In G1.1b, you have this equation, MUR is equal to 0.87 FY AST D. Now in this one, everything is known except the value of AST. You can find the, right? This equation is given here. You go back and refer, right, in the code. Should MER nothing but this MER is nothing but whatever moment of moment I have got total factored moment, that is I am going to put MU, right? That is MU into 0.87 FY AST small d 1 minus FY into AST. Many times students make actually this calculation can be made very simple. Again, multiply here. Instead, what you do is you take all this term on the left side like this, 128 into 10 power 6 divided by 0.87 divided by 415 divided by 460. So right hand side will be much easier. Only AST will be there. Here it is 1. Here AST square will come. Right? Now you can calculate what is this value is. This coming out, this left hand part alone coming out to be 770.7. This is AST. 1 minus 415 divided by this is 1.804843 into 10 power minus 4 AST. Now you expand this, you get a quadratic equation. Okay. So 1.8043 into 10 power minus 4 AST square minus AST plus 770.7 equal to 0. Right? You in your calculator, you have a function for to solving the quadratic equation. You can use that one. Right? If you solve this one, obviously you will get two roots. The two roots are, on solving this quadratic equation, you will get AST 1 as 4617 millimeter square and AST 2 as 925 point something millimeter square. Is that clear? Now, the doubt is which one to take. Both are correct root, but which one to take? Which is the appropriate value to be taken in the design? Right? Remember, the cost of the steel is almost 75 times the cost of concrete. Okay. So will satisfy this moment, and I will go with the smallest value because I want to have a very economical design, and also I do not want an over reinforced section. So I am going to choose only the lowest value, right? So obviously I am not going to take this value 4617 millimeter square. It's a very high value. I do not want. So I am not. This is not a realistic value. I am going to choose only lowest value. So among these two, AST required AST is the least of these two. Whichever is the least, this one. Now let us say this value is A. This value is A. Now question is it sufficient? How to know whether this is sufficient or not? Is a minimum percentage of steel to be provided in any element, right? Now for that we have to check, right? So next step is check for minimum tensile reinforcement, right? This is given AST minimum by BD is equal to 0.85 by FY. It is given in a 26,000. Please go back and remember AST minimum by BD is equal to 0.85 divided by FY. So find out AST minimum from this one, because now you know B, you know D, you know FY. So you are finding out AST minimum divided by B is 250. All these things you substitute for all the values. So you are getting AST minimum is 235.54 millimeter square. Let us say this is B. Okay. Now what is your final AST required to take the moment of 126 kilonewton meter? That's what we have to come up. So in the previous one, A was around 900 and something. Now from this one, AST minimum, we are getting 235.54. Minimum, you should provide this much steel. You can have more than this, but not less than this. So you are, therefore, AST required is the greatest of A and B. This A is 926, B is 235. Whichever is the greatest value, that is your AST required. AST required is greatest of A and B. Suppose, let us say, the A value was only 195. Let us say this A value is only 195 and B is coming out to 235. Then AST required will automatically will become 235, not 195. Okay, is that clear? I hope everyone is clear with that one. So this is the important step. AST required is greatest of A and B, that is 926 millimeter square. This much of area of steel should be provided in the tension zone to take care of a moment of 126 kilonewton meter. Okay. Now, how to provide this one? For that, you should know, I am given here, this is the diameter of one bar, 12 mm diameter bar or 16 mm diameter bar or 20 mm bar. Likewise, I have given diameter and corresponding area I have given on the right side. For example, one 12 mm bar will have a cross-sectional area of 113 millimeter square. Similarly, 16 mm diameter rod will have a 201 millimeter square. Likewise, you can find out for all other diameter. I already given you in the last class what are the various diameter bars available in the market. You don't have a 13, you don't have a 15, you know, you don't have a 17 mm and all, not there. You cannot use any diameter you want in the design. You have to use the diameter of the steel that is available in the market. Okay, so these are the available. I have given only few here. There are many more I have not included here. So by looking at this one, if you know these values, I know I have to provide 926 millimeter square minimum. I have to provide 926 millimeter square. I can provide 926 or little bit more than this. Round about this value I would provide. I should not provide less than this. I can provide little bit more than AST required here. That is why this dam is AST required. Okay, AST required is minimally you should have 926 millimeter. Table to find out. For example, let us say 125 is 491, right? So you have to provide two numbers of main reinforcement as a tensile reinforcement in the beam, which I discussed last class. Minimum, you should have a two rods at the bottom, two rods at the top as a hanger bar or the anchor bar. At the bottom, main steel, minimum two. If I take this 25 mm diameter bar, 2 into 491 is how much? 982, right? 982, which is that. No, no, I want to go with a less. Let us say I will go with 22. If I go with 22, obviously 926 divided by 380 will be 2 point something. That means as soon as you get to 2 point something, 2.0 numbers only, you cannot provide less than 2. Suppose if your value is coming out to be, let us say 926, let us say I need the AST required is 926. I know 122 mm diameter bar is 380. Tell me what is this value 926 by number of 2.43 means okay. Any single digit is sufficient. 2.43 or 2.4, whatever. Any value greater than 2 means you have to provide 3 numbers of bars. So 3 into 380 is how much? 1140, eh?
Yes, sir.
So you record. So I want to, this is becoming more. So let us say I will go with 20 mm diameter bar, this one, right? So if I go with 20 mm bars, I'll just erase this. If I go with 20 mm bar, number of 20 mm bar required, 20 mm bars divided by 314. So how much is coming?
2.94, sir.
94. So I can provide, it is almost equal to 3. So I can provide 3 numbers of 20 mm bars, three numbers of 20 mm dia bar. So I will get 3 into 314 is 942 millimeter square, right? So I need 926 and I am providing 942. This is the most closest value I can get it. Okay, so you can have a combination of bar also. You can provide let us say 2 number of 22 plus 1 number of 16. How much it will be? Let us say I will provide 2 number of 22 plus 1 number of 16. Then what will happen? 2 number of 22 is 380 plus 201. It is coming out to be 760 plus 201. 961 millimeter square. This is also fine, but this is coming more than this. So I am going to go with this one. So you should know these values. All these values you should know. Then you can easily come up with the number of bars easily. Okay. So that's what I'm writing next. Provide three number of 20 mm diameter bars. So therefore, 314 942 millimeter square. Remember my value should always be greater than AST required. If it is less than AST required, your structure will fail. It cannot take the moment of 126 kilonewton meter. That ME value it cannot take. Okay. So now check for AST max, because as given in your code, there should be a restriction on the amount of reinforcement that you provide. So if you refer 26.5. maximum area of tensile reinforcement is 0.04 times B into capital D. So 0.04 B into capital D is coming out to be 5000 millimeter square. So AST you have provided only 942, which is less than AST max. So your AST provided is 942, which is greater than this AST minimum and less than AST max. So your design is absolutely correct. Okay. So your check is okay. This much AST is fine. Your provided AST should be more than AST minimum. It should be less than AST maximum. Okay. And these values are check for AST minimum and AST maximum. Next, check for spacing of tensile reinforcement. Remember, we also discussed about spacing of tensile. 250 mm is given as the width of the beam. Now depth you have found out to be 500 mm. That is 500 mm. Now we have provided three numbers of 20 mm bars, like here, three numbers of 20 mm bars. Now, what is the spacing between these bars? The spacing between these two bars should be within the limit. That. So, this is three numbers which I told you. Now, this small d is 460 mm, that effective depth. Now, assuming mild exposure. Mild is because the exposure condition is not given to you. I am assuming to be a mild exposure and 8 mm diastereps, right? Nominal cover from table 16 of IS 456 is 20 mm, which I told you sometime back here. Nominal cover, here you see, nominal cover to meet durability requirements. For a mild exposure, it is 20 mm. Is that clear? Nominal cover and clear cover both are one and the same for all practical purposes. So I am assuming that it's a mild exposure. That means I have to this clear distance, this clear cover from here to here, till here to here, I have to provide minimum of 20 mm. That is called clear. This one. Okay, I'll just zoom a little bit here. This is the clear cover. Okay, this red color arrow here. This is nominal cover up to the stirrups outside. Now I'm assuming 8 mm diastereps. 8 mm diastereps mean this diameter is 8 mm diameter. Okay. So now what is the So what is the spacing available between these two bars? So I can find out spacing provided is 250 mm. Total is from here to here is 250 mm. Width of the beam is 250 mm. Okay. Minus two side cover. This is 20 mm. This right side also 20 mm. So now I have come to this length. Okay. Now I have two diameter of stirrups. This stirrups is there. This stirrups is there. I have to reduce the diameter. So minus two times the diameter of the stirrups. Then I have come up to this edge. From here to here I have come. Okay. So if you draw, actually if you draw it, sorry. if I draw only at the bottom. If I this is my 250, that is the width of the beam, right? Let us say I have provided three number of 20 mm bars here, here, and then here. Okay. This is the stirrups. I will draw in different color. Let us say this is my stirrups. This is my stirrups. Okay. So 250. This is my side cover 30 mm. This is also side cover 20 mm. That is this. Now up to here stirrups I reduced. Now this total, I have three number of between here and here. I have three number of 20 mm diameter bar. That is this three number of 20. I am getting this distance and this distance. How many number of spacing is there? Number of bars 1, 2, 3. That is number of bar minus 1. Because if you provide 3 bars, you will always have a 2 spacing. One spacing here, one spacing here. So always, so 3 minus 1. I am getting 67 millimeters. Okay. So spacing provided 67 millimeters. We have to check whether it is within the limits or not. Now, SH minimum is, as you know in the code, if you see in the class 26.3.2 here, minimum distance between individual bars. You can very well, you can reject this. You can only consider second and third. Okay. Second includes the first one also. Second and third, if you read, the diameter is the largest bar. Here diameter of bar is how much? 20 mm. And 5 mm more than the nominal maximum size of core aggregate. Generally, we use 20 mm as a core aggregate. So 5 mm more than the size of aggregate is 20. So 25, this third will give 25. This is 20 mm. So whichever is greater, that will be 25 mm. That's what I have written here. So greatest of 20 mm is the size of the largest bar, and 25 mm is 20 mm plus 5 mm. 20 mm is the nominal size of the aggregate plus 5 mm. So whichever is greater, 25 mm. So minimum I should have 25 mm gap between these two bars. I have 67 mm. That is fine. Similarly, SH maximum is 180 mm for Fe415 and 0 degree distribution. Remember, I saw table 15 sometime back. You can see that here. Maximum distance between bar here. Then here it will be written. Maximum distance between bars in tension for the beams is given in table 15. So here is table 15. These are the three values for Fe250 300 mm, for Fe415 which is your steel, you have to take 180 mm. For I told you only 0 degree distribution we are going to consider, not the other one. So SH maximum is 180 mm. Okay. So now if you check it, your SH minimum is 25 mm, SH provided 67 mm, SH maximum is 180 mm, your SH provided is within the range, which is greater than SH minimum and less than SH max. So your, suppose you are not satisfying this check. Let us say you have provided instead of three number, let us say you have provided five or six numbers of smaller diameter bars. Obviously the spacing between those two bars will become very less, so you should go for a, I can go with instead of three number of 20 mm, I can go with let us say for a 10 mm diameter bar, it is 78.5 is the area. So 960 divided by 78 means almost it will be 9 bars or 8 bars. If you provide 8 bars here, obviously the spacing between the successive is it clear? So you should choose the number of bars in such a way that the spacing of the tension reinforcement or spacing of reinforcement is satisfied. This criteria should be satisfied. Otherwise, you should change the number. Okay. And sometimes, in some cases, let us say you provided maybe more than 180 mm. Now, that time also, that is not allowed. You should provide more than 2. Is that clear? So these are the practical aspects you should look into it. Your provided number of steel should not be very less or should not be too many. It should satisfy this this criteria. Okay. Next, check for ductility. This step is not completely required, but if you have time, you can do it. Strain at the level of steel bar near tension phase. If it is more than 0.0038, then you can say the failure will be ductile. For example, you find out the value of XU. XU by D is equal to 0.87 FY AST 0.36 FCK BD. Now, this DD get cancelled. So, you can easily find out what is the value of XU. XU is coming out to be 188.95 millimeters. Right? Now, obviously, either you can do this one or you find out XE max. If XE is less than XE max, obviously your failure will be ductile. Or another way is to you find out the strain at the level of steel. For XU distance, it is 0.0035. From the strain diagram of concrete and steel, you know already, right? The maximum strain in the concrete compression is 0.0035. That will be at a distance of XU. Now, D minus XU, what is the strain? That strain is coming out to 0.00502. Since it is greater than 0.0038, because strain at the level of steel near tension, if it is more than 0.0038, failure will be ductile. So obviously, because check for ductility is okay, or you can also check with XU, XU limit or XU max, then also failure will be ductile. Okay, this is the sixth step. If this check is not satisfied, then increase the effective depth of the beam, then till you get this check is correct. Okay, that is another. Now, for this is the last check before finishing the design. Now, check for serviceability. By far, this is this one, right? So, for a beam to be safe in deflection, your L effective by D provided. L effective by D provided should be less than L effective by D basic value into alpha, beta, gamma, and xi or zeta. Right? Where is this given? It is given in the code here. If you scroll back. Here, 23.2.1. Depth ratio should not be greater than the values mentioned below. So, for a simple, this one, this A is, this L by D basic is this A, that is 20 value, okay? This B is the, this alpha. Here alpha is this B, this factor, length factor, span factor. Beta is the modification factor for the tensile steel, this one. This gamma is the modification factor for a compression steel. And this eta or xi is related to the T beam here, that is flanged beam or T beam. Okay, now we will see here. L effective by D provided, you already calculated, right? L effect by D basic value is 20 for a simply supported beam from class 23.2.1a. This L effective by D basic value, this is. Now, alpha is a correction factor for span. In our case, it is only because our span is only, effective span is only 8 meter. If it is less than 10 meter, you will take only 1. If it is more than 10 meter, you will use the correction factor as given in this section. Now beta is a modification factor for tensile strength from figure 4 that we will see now. Now gamma is a modification factor. It become 1 because we are not providing any compression steel. It is a singly reinforced steel. In a doubly reinforced beam only you will have a compression steel. In a singly reinforced beam only tensile strength will be there. Although in the compression zone you will have a hanger bar or an anchor bar, that is not the main steel. Okay, so you cannot call that as a compression steel. Now finally zeta is a modification factor for a flanged beam. That is also flanged beam. So out of these all four factors, alpha is one, gamma is one, find out this beta, that is a modification factor for a tensile steel. Now here you see beta is equal to modification factor for tensile steel from figure 4 of IS 456 2000. Now this is the, if you have a code you can refer to it, otherwise you will always feel problem here, right? Now if you see this, there are three parameters. One is percentage tensile reinforcement here on the x-axis, and you have a fs value in this for from 120 to 290. There is a fs value here. There are 5 curves running here, and here is a modification factor for a tensile steel is given. Now how to find this out? So if you go back to your code, this is the graph I have drawn. .58 Fy into area of cross section of steel required divided by area of cross section of steel provided. Please remember this. This is the Fs formula. It is given in the code, page number 38. Fs equal to 0.58 Fy. So I am going to steal here. Fs equal to 0.58 Fy into AST required divided by AST provided. So 0.58 is a constant. That's fine. Fy is 415. AST required is how much? How much is the AST okay? 926 or so, right? In your AST provided was 942. So if you substitute all those things, 0.58, FY is 415, AST required was 926, AST provided was 942. So FS value is coming out to be 236.6 MPa. Okay. Now what is the x-axis? Percentage of tension reinforcement. PT is equal to 100 AST by BD. This AST is AST provided. So PT is equal to 100 AST provided by BD. 100 AST provided is 942 into BD is this one. This is coming out to 0.819. So I have these two values, 0.81. Percentage of tensile reinforcement provided is 0.819 and the FSS value is 236. Now from this curve I have to find a modification factor. Now look at this 0.819 in the graph. This PT is a percentage of tensile reinforcement provided. So now here if you see, it is in the interval of 0.2, this 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, 1.2, like that up to 3% is there, right? Now your value is 0.82, almost 0.82. So this is, I will draw a line at 0.82. This is, so for FS equal 236.61 and this blue line here, this is the 0.82 line. Now look at this one, in this curve, in this straight line you look at, what is this value? This curve value is 290. This curve value is 240. This curve value is 240. This curve value is 190. Now what is the difference between this and this? Between this 190 and then 240, what is the difference? 240 minus 190 is 50, right? And this FS value is almost close to 240. So I am taking 236.6, something like this, somewhere here. Okay. Now what is the modification factor here? This is the modification factor. So this is 0.8. This is 1. In the middle, it will be 1.1, but it is slightly less than the middle value. Okay, this value here, this junction, one. What I have taken this as a beta is 1.07 from. You have a, in the x-axis, you have a percentage of tensile reinforcement provided. That is coming out to 0.819. So I am marking that line 0.819 here. Now for FS value, I got 236.61. So in the line, you have to see this 190 curve. This curve is 190 curve. This curve is 240 curve. So 236 will be close to 240. So there is somewhere here. That value, that is the value of beta, or here they are given modification factor KT. Even anything is beta is equal to 1.07. Okay. This is one. This middle value is one. Between 1 and 1.2 is 1.1. That is will be little 0.08, 1.09 also. That does not matter. But it should be almost 0.07. So now L effective by D provided is how much? 860. That value is coming out to be 17.39. Now I am going to evaluate this right side part. L effective by D basically for a simply supported beam is 20. Alpha is 1 because my span is less than 10 meters. Beta just now we calculated 1.07. Gamma is 1 because there is no compression steel. Zeta is equal to 1 because we are designing only a rectangular beam, not a blanched beam. So this value is coming out to be 21.4. Obviously 17.39 is less than 21.4. Therefore, your beam is safe in deflection. If this is not safe, you have to change this D value. You have to increase the value of D and increase the value of rainfall AST, like whatever. You can adjust it and get this value such a way that your L effective by D provided is less than this value. So therefore, the beam is safe in deflection. Now, finally, is detailing of reinforcement, right? This is the final step, detailing of reinforcement. What you have is, first of all, what you did, width was given as 250 mm. First thing you designed was what is the total depth. We have designed as 500 mm. So mark that 500 mm. This is the 500 mm design. This is a cross section of the beam. Then next, what you designed? You designed AST should be 3 number of 20 mm diameter bars. That is, so this is effective depth. So this is at this effective depth, you provided 3 number of 20 mm diameter. Bending tension reinforcement is equal to 3 number of 20 mm bars. And the effective cover is 40 mm because we assumed 40 mm. So this 40 mm effective cover. Now provide 2 number of 8 mm diameter hanger bars. This is a hanger bars. Because code says minimum you should have I will clarify you with you next time, but let us say this is a hanger bars. This you don't need right now, but it's okay. And you provide stirrups. This is called stirrups, okay, right? But your design end here, this is a two-legged 8 mm diameter vertical stirrups, but for this unit you can end with here itself. This is a size. And this is the 3 number of 20 mm diameter bars. This is the effective depth. So this is the complete design. Okay. Tell me, is there any doubt? This is the end of your this first design. Are you all there? It's a pin drop silence.
Yes, sir.
Any doubt?
No, sir.
Obviously, this is a very lengthy one. You have to go back and refer everything, and you have to solve it. Many times, students make mistake. One second. Please mute yourself. So, you go back and refer to all these things. First of all, given data, then you find out the factored moment. Then this is the factored moment. Finding, then you find out the effective depth required for a balanced section, then provide a depth little greater than that is required for balance section to make it as an under reinforced section. Q by D is correct or not, it is coming out to 17.39, that is fine. Or if the effective cover is given, you take that value to come up with the overall dimension. Then design the area of tensile reinforcement, right? Then in the next slide, you are getting two AST. Suppose, let us say you have gone with 4617 millimeter square, right? This 4617 millimeter square is almost close to 5000 millimeter square. That is the maximum AST. 4% of B to D, that was 5000 millimeter square. So obviously you are going to get very high AST. Okay. And if you provide 4617, it will be a over reinforced section. Is that clear? For example, where you calculated XC here, right? Something 4500, let us say 4500 means it is almost five. If this value will become five times more means it will be 5158, it will become 900 mm, it will be outside the your section, so it will become a over reinforced section. That is why we should not take the higher AST. Okay, so you have taken the lower AST, that is, but you have to check with the AST 235, whichever is greater, you take as the AST required. So from this diameter of R, you manipulate it and get it to the right required, and this AST provided should always be greater than AST required. Then finally you check AST provided is greater than AST minimum and less than AST max, then it is fine. Otherwise you have to change the AST provided. Then you find out the spacing of the tension right for than minimum cover, less than, and then you check for ductility, then check for deflection. Any design problems should always end with a figure something like this. Here I only drawn cross section. They may ask you to draw the longitudinal section also, but longitudinal section we will draw after finishing the third unit. Otherwise longitudinal section will not look nice because you are not designing the stirrups, so it will be a problem. Okay, so that is a design. Okay, so I just wanted to more thing. Let us say you have this is a design problem too. A cantilever beam of clear span 2 meter is subjected to an UDL of 10 kN per meter together with a point load of 20 kN at its free end. The width, design the beam for flexure, grade of concrete and steel is given. Now if you carefully look at this problem, what you have to design? You have to design a cantilever beam. Now UDL is given as 10 kN per meter together with a point. What is not given here in this load? Anybody? Any guess? Compared to the previous one, what is not given here? Yeah, exactly. Self weight of the beam is not given. So that means you have to calculate self weight of the beam and add to this load. Is that clear? Because without self weight of the load, if you self weight of the beam, if you design, your design is wrong. Your design will fail. Is that clear? You should never forget to add the self weight of the beam while calculating the factored bending moment. So here, you know, these are the given data, cantilever beam given, length. Remember, it's only given clear span. This is only clear span. It is not effective span. So clear span is, I have written only L, not L effective. B is 250 mm. UDL intensity is 10 kN per meter. Is it a factor load or service load?
Service load,
yes, because there is no factored or limit or design is given. Factored, it is a service load. And a point load at the free end also given 20 kN, right? FCK is given 20 MPa, FY is 12. So this is your cantilever beam, you can see here. This is the cantilever, this is a fixed end. Clear span is from the face to the free end of the beam, 2 meters. UDL is 10 kN per meter. External UDL, 20 kN is the point load acting at the free end. Okay. Where will be the bending moment maximum? Where will be the shear force maximum?
At fixed end, the bending moment will be maximum.
So if you draw the shear force diagram will be something like this, because there is a 20 kN load here. This is a 20 kN and then total it will be 40 kN. Okay, this is the shear force diagram. So at the free end you have 20 kN, but at the fixed end you have a double the amount. Okay. Whereas if you draw the bending moment diagram, what is the value of bending moment at the free end of the cantilever? Jagadish, 54. Are you there? 54.
Yes, sir.
What is the bending moment at the free end of the cantilever beam? Jagadish. You know or not?
Okay.
41. Are you there? Yes, sir. Please go back and refer to strength of material SM1, fundamentals of shear force and bending moment diagram, because without that you cannot design. So if you draw the bending moment diagram is going to be like this, where the bending moment is zero at the free end and parabolically where is here. Okay, that value you can calculate. I am not writing the values on purpose, but you should know the bending moment is maximum at the fixed end and zero at the free end. And you are designing the beam for flexure or a bending moment, right? In this problem, you are designing the beam for a flexure or bending, not for shear. So obviously, your bending moment is zero. That means your section can be very less here. But at the fixed end, your section should be more because it has a maximum bending moment. Remember, you will always design the beam for a maximum bending moment. Whatever maximum bending moment coming into the structure, for that max. So here is the maximum bending moment. So when the bending moment at the free end is zero and maximum at the fixed end, the beam can be designed for maximum bending moment and the minimal depth can be provided at the free end. So so here if you see this blue line, blue color beam, it seems like a uniform depth, but you don't have to have a uniform depth height. You can have a more height at the fixed end. And when you go towards the free end, your depth of the beam is zero at the free end. Because your bending moment is zero at the free end, you can reduce the depth of the beam at the free end of the cantilever. Right? So, your next step is to find the overall depth of the beam as before. Remember, as I told you, design means you have to be very careful with the number of steps and a very systematic way you should go, step by step manner. There cannot be unique answer, but steps should be unique. All the steps, first, obviously you cannot find out AST first before finding out, because AST you design for a maximum bending moment. Maximum bending moment you can find only including the self weight. If you have to include the self weight, you should know the size of the beam. So After the given data, you are first finding out the overall depth of the beam. Now here in this beam, since the self weight of the beam is not added to the load, we have to find out the self weight of the beam. Therefore, first find out the overall depth of 2.1a. That is again same here in your code. What is the value for cantilever? Span to effective depth for cantilever, it is 7. So that is 7 given. So you can take for cantilever beam, span to effective depth ratio should be less than or equal to 7. So if you take this value, 1000 millimeter divided by 7 is coming here to be 285.71 millimeters. Okay. But remember, this is only approximate, this is not the exact value. It depends upon your bending moment value, because your, suppose your span may be small, your depth may be more, this value may be less than 7, but if your bending moment value is very high, obviously this depth will not be sufficient. Okay, so let us say required was only 285.71, but I am providing 410. Somebody could ask how you achieve 410, right? For that, what I have to do, I have to go in a little bit in an iterative manner. Let us say I provided only 300 mm, okay? Assume that I provided only 300 mm. Then what will happen? I will assume some effective cover and let us say I provided only 350 mm as the overall depth, okay? Now I found out overall depth as 350 mm. Right? Forget about this with the 350 mm as the overall depth for an example. Now, in the next is forget about this point. I am just going to only explain. I am not going to solve here. Now, to find out factored bending moment, you know UDL on the beam is 10 kN. That is a live load. That is, remember, WLL, small WLL means it is a live load. UDL on the beam live load is 10 kN per meter is given in the problem. Now you have to add self weight. Now self weight, how will you find out? As I told you, let us say this is your beam. The width is given as 250 mm. This is 2 meter. Let us say I am telling only 350 mm, okay? Now, your UDL is given in terms of kilonewton per meter. So, for example, we will calculate also self weight only for 1 meter. 1 meter length we calculate. Let us say for only this 1 meter length we calculate. Self weight is nothing but unit weight or weight density of concrete multiplied by the volume. Now, weight density or unit weight of a reinforced cement concrete, how much? Do you remember? That is 25 kilonewton per meter cube. So, self weight, if you want to find out, 25 kilonewton per meter cube multiplied by volume for 1 meter length only I am finding out. 1 meter length volume means 1 meter multiplied by this. So, I will find out 25 kilonewton per meter cube multiplied by 1 meter multiplied by 0.25 meter multiplied by 0.35 meter. How much is this? Find out. Somebody tell me the answer.
2.18.
How much?
2.18.
Kilonewton per meter meter cube. This is meter. This is meter. This is meter. You should get only kilonewton. Now why we are writing kilonewton per meter? You understood, na? We are finding out the self weight for 1 meter length. self weight is nothing but unit weight multiplied by volume, or weight density multiplied by volume. So 25 kilonewton per meter cube multiplied by 1 meter multiplied by 0.25 meter multiplied by 0.35 meter, I should get 2.18 kilonewton, right? This 2.818 kilonewton is only for 1 meter length, not for 2 meter length. Is that clear? This 2.18 is only for 1. Finally, we will write 2.18 kilonewton per meter length or 1 meter. That is why this 2.18 kilonewton. Or in many cases, what you can do is unit weight unit weight of concrete multiplied by cross-sectional area. This one you forget about it. Then you will assume kilonewton per meter cube into meter square is equal to kilonewton per meter. Okay. Sometimes people may get confused why it is kilonewton per meter, why not kilonewton. It is 2.1 kilonewton only, 2.18 kilonewton only, but this we have calculated for only for 1 meter length, because sometimes your span may be 3 meter, 5 meter, 10 meter, whatever the span. But for 1 meter span, this will always be constant. That is why we are taking it as a UDL. And moreover, the self weight of the beam will always act as a UDL. The self weight of the beam will always act as a UDL. That is why we should represent in terms of kilonewton per meter the self weight. Is everyone clear about it? Anyhow, anybody having any doubt? Okay, so right, so total is coming out to be 10 plus 2.18, so 12.18 kilonewton per meter is coming. So if you take this beam, this UDL is including self weight is 12.18 kilonewton per meter, and this is a 20 kilonewton load is here, right? 20 or 10. Let it be okay. So now what is the maximum bending moment here? What is the maximum bending moment? How will you find out bending moment for this? First of all, only for a point load you find out. Only for a point load, if you okay. Okay, so maybe I'll continue in the next class.